a professor from the Mansfield branch. So, without any further ado, Mr. George Warren.
Thank you, Josh, and thank all of you tonight for being here. Special thanks to the Young Republican Club and the Women's Republican Club for hosting the event. For Dr. Wagner's, you still know him if you bump around on the internet sites. He's the founder of CO2 is Life, and also the internet skeptic for the last 4 years. You'll find out as he gets into his presentation that economics and science kind of blend together in the evaluations of data and statistical models and computer models and so forth. So you'll see that his skill in that area has been very beneficial and actually got him involved in this thing in the first place. Basically, I think that's pretty much it. And so without further ado, Dr. Wagner, microphone yours.
All right, I want to thank everyone for having me here. Richfield Women's Republicans, Josh, Sid, and everybody for having me out here. As George said, we've been giving this presentation for a little while. My background is in economics, finance, and optometry. And you're probably thinking, why in the world am I talking about climate change? Well, what you're going to find is that a large number of people that are the major players in global climate change, you'll see that they are economists. As a matter of fact, the person that hit the IPCC, Dr. Churi, his background is in economics. It's the multivariable modeling techniques that they use in climate modeling that they use in the financial sector. In fact, the first climate models were nothing more than financial models edited. And that's what kind of got me involved in this. Also, I was trying to figure out a way, how do you ever teach a simple scientific model where there's cause and effect? You know, where you change one thing and it leads to a change in the other one. I thought this was a great example. We had one, everyone has heard about it. Global warming, you increase CO2, and then temperature increases. And I thought this would be a great example for me to use to teach students a very simple model. But when I started to take a look at it, I started to realize there wasn't a lot of truth to that. When I started digging into it, every time there'd be a claim, I would look into it, and I'd say, wait a minute, the data doesn't quite support the conclusions. And after I got into it more and more, I thought, this makes a really good story. So I put it together, and that's what we've been doing for the last 4 years, is taking this out, and basically just helping to educate the population on the science behind global warming, and we let you decide whether or not you feel the science behind it is solid enough to really justify all the changes that they're talking about making. The good news is, the message that I think we've been trying to get out is finally getting out. If you take a look here, now only 34% of the population blame humans for global warming. The skeptics, like myself, are now the majority, which is a good thing. So if you're a skeptic like myself, you're no longer alone, you're actually in the majority. I think that's a very good thing. People are actually starting to take a look at it. I don't know if you saw recently, but they had Al Gore came to Congress. Now there's a lot of legislation that's pending, and they're working on getting it through. So Al Gore came and he was able to give his side. The problem with it was, some skeptics came. Lord Monckton came. And they wouldn't allow him to talk. Now, in an American system based on free speech, I have a real problem when the government allows one side to give their story and they rule out the other side. Okay? And that's what they did. And I'm going to give you that other side so you get to decide whether or not it should have been heard. Okay? And the reason they didn't let Lord Monckton give a speech is because he's written something called 35 Inconvenient Truths. It's a very convincing piece. And he basically takes apart Al Gore's movie with some very good scientific arguments. And yet they would not allow this man to speak. Okay? People like myself have been criticizing many parts of Al Gore's movie and many parts of the science for quite some time. And finally, it looks like he's actually listened to a few, and he's actually, believe it or not, agreed and has removed some of the slides from his movie because even he couldn't continue to agree that, you know, there was any facts behind what he was saying. Okay. So I know what you've been told. Alright, I've looked into it. Alright, very deeply. Okay, but what I'd like you to do for the next 40 minutes or so, I want you to forget everything you've been told. Alright? I want you to be like a forensic scientist, and we're going to take a look at science. Alright? But I don't want you to have any preconceived notions. Now, I want you to do something that's very dangerous. I want you to open your mind. All right? Now we're going to take a look at the science. But first of all, let's make sure we understand what we've been told.
Few challenges facing America and the world are more urgent than combating climate change. The science is beyond dispute, and the facts are clear. Sea levels are rising. Coastlines are shrinking. We've seen record drought, the spread of famine, and storms that are growing stronger with each passing hurricane season. Climate change and our dependence on foreign oil, if left unaddressed, will continue to weaken our economy and threaten our national security.
Okay. That's the most powerful man in the world, and he just gave you a chain of statements. Those are hypotheses, and we're going to go test those. But remember what you've been told, and heard, I'm sure you've heard it 100 times, but let's go take a look at those claims. All right. Why did we give this presentation? I've always said that if they ever took a look at this stuff in a court of law, there's no way the science would pass to anyone with an ounce of common sense. And sure enough, they took Al Gore's movie to court over in England. And sure enough, what did they find? They found that Al Gore's movie was alarmist. And they found 9 significant errors in this movie. So when I go through this presentation, you'll see that I'll cut these boxes out to kind of support the conclusion that I'll reach. But those conclusions were reached in a trial by jury where people looked at it and said, no way. Well, let's go take a look. The way that I created this presentation is I had the good fortune of being living down by OSU. So what I've done is I've been able to go and attend many of the events at OSU. And when I see these presentations, I try to clip out the best parts that I can find to put together. So none of this is my own research. It's all the IPCC's research or other significant climate scientists. I looked at the best arguments and I pulled them together. This just comes from Dr. Singer. He was there a couple weeks ago and he had a very good presentation. And what I've done is I've pulled out a couple points that he made that I thought were very effective. And the first point he makes is that evidence of warming is not evidence that man is causing it. We've been through many, many warming and cooling cycles. None of them were due to man. And this cycle, more than likely, is no different from any of the past. So just because you're warming doesn't mean man's causing it. And this is how you tell if it's warming. Right? We all heard that it's global warming. Well, if there's global warming, you've got to have what's called a fingerprint. What you do is you have to have warming of the atmosphere, right? So what you would see is you'd see here the chart. Now the way this show goes, as you notice, you don't know what this is yet. And so I'm just going to ask questions and you're going to tell me what it says. All right, but right here you have a chart that has the altitude, and down here you have the North Pole and the South Pole. And right here is basically lower atmosphere, and it's nice and red, meaning it's hot, right? So when I take a look at that, I would describe this as warming in the Earth's atmosphere. I go over here and I've got the exact same chart. But it says the same thing, but it's the exact opposite. It's like a mirror image because the lower atmosphere is cooling. So the question is, I've got two charts showing the exact opposite thing. The question is, what are these charts, right? Well, what do you think they are? One of them is a computer model. One is actual observations. The computer models show warming. The observations show cooling. This is the only science I know of where a computer model counts as evidence of anything. Bernie Madoff had a great computer model, and you can see where that got him, right? I work in the financial industry, I can build a model that'll tell you anything, right? But the key is, when you look at the science and you see it repeated, the observations do not match the theory or the computer models. And who would you go with? Now, are you going to drive your car based upon a computer model or what you see coming ahead of you? Right? Just common sense would say you rely on the observations, not some computer model, especially when they're going 180 degrees off. Here's another one. When I look at this chart, and the whole point is if I give any misrepresentations, you're supposed to go, hey Bob, you're misinterpreting that chart. Right? But I'm just going to help give eyes to you. But when I look at this chart, I see a bunch of red bars over here and black bars over here. But when I look up there, I see about an even number, just to make a few more bars over here. But they seem to be going in different ways like a tree. Is that a fair statement? Right? But if I look over here, I've got like Texas Gulf, Missouri, here, Soros, raining. Okay. But what is this right here? Those are computer models. Right? And what that shows you is that if you wanted to claim that it was rainy in Suarez, you would choose this model. If you wanted to claim it was dry, you would choose that model. And that's what these models were used in Al Gore's movie. So there basically was no point he could not prove by simply picking and choosing whatever computer model he wanted to use. That to me is the worst science ever. And if you ever use that for like drug research and turn it into the FDA, you would probably be behind bars. Right? Now I want you to start thinking, you're now a forensic scientist, and there's been a crime committed, right? And you went on the OSU website and you read about this Mount Kilimanjaro glacier has melted. This is Dr. Thompson, the lead man at the Bird Wall Research Center, and he tells you it's due to global warming. Credible source, it's due to warming. But you're a forensic scientist, and you're to get to the truth. You're looking right here, this is a melting glacier. Anyone notice anything funny about it? What's missing from this picture? There's plenty of snow. What's missing from a melting glacier picture? Where's the water? This is bone dry, right? There's not an ounce of water anywhere. Look, even over here, there's no water anywhere. You don't see a river. You see a bone dry area. The other thing is, if this is a melting glacier, by definition, what has to happen? Well, if I'm going to melt anything, what has to happen? It has to be above freezing, right? Didn't anyone ever bother to ask how warm it is on top of Mount Kilimanjaro? It's up 19,340 feet. It never gets above freezing. Anyone here in the military? What happens if you walk out on a wing that high up? You're an ice cube. It never gets above freezing up there. And yet they're telling you it's melting. Who's a chemistry major? This is freeze drying. It's a process called sublimation. If you take an ice cube, blow air over it, it'll evaporate. So sublimation, it's a solid to gas, but it has absolutely nothing to do with warming and everything to do with the dryness of the air. In fact, when they took a look at it over in England, they agreed with me. They said, Al, you can't melt a glacier in sub-zero temperatures unless we rewrite all the chemistry and physics books, and I don't think we want to do that just to push this nonsense, all right? Let's take a look here. Here's another chart. This is one of my favorite ones. This to me, when I look at it, and you once again tell me if I'm misinterpreting this chart, this starts out at 10 back in 1965, and it goes up to about 30 in 1996, which by, I'm gonna give you a little hint on this one, 1996 was one of the warmest years of the last century, right? And then it drops down to about 25. But would anyone disagree with me if I told you that that is a sharply increasing chart? It goes from 10 to 30, that's a 300% increase, in a little bit over, what, 30 years or 40 years. Anyone gonna disagree with me that's increasing in a big way? We can all agree on that. My eyes aren't lying to me. So what is this chart? Anyone wanna take a guess? That's a polar bear population. Okay, polar bears are going through the roof. If you take a look at it, only 2 out of 13 populations of polar bear have been declining. That means 11 out of 13 have been stable or increasing. Now do the math. Okay, I think the polar bear population is doing just fine. More importantly, if you take a look at it, the polar bears are thriving as the Arctic warms up. The only problem is you have to go over to England to read these kind of headlines. We don't seem to report this kind of stuff here in the United States. This is one of the best quotes I can find on this. Polar bears stand a greater chance of avoiding extinction if people stop shooting them than if we stop producing greenhouse gases. You can literally still hunt polar bears. I probably have a feeling that that might do a little bit to the population. All right, this comes from a geography presentation I got off one of the university websites, and the guy points out that, yeah, the biggest populations occur during the warmest years. That's just common sense. The warmer it is, it's easier for an animal to survive. And sure enough, once again, the message is finally getting through. President Obama agrees with us now, at least me. Okay? And he agreed with President Bush. That was all nonsense we give. We're not going to make the polar bear endangered. And sure enough, they looked at it over in England as well. They found the exact same thing. They did the same thing with the coral. So whenever you hear this about the corals being killed by global warming, they looked at that, nothing there. Okay, we go out on a limb again. This chart goes back to 74. This is the current level. This started out at 1,400. It now looks like it's about 1,100. This looks like the Dow Jones Industrial over the last year, right? Would anyone disagree with me that this is near or at a record low? Would anyone disagree with me that it looks like it's falling off the cliff? Right? So what is this chart? Anyone want to take a guess? President Obama did not read the newspaper, but it was right here, USA Today. 30-year low in the northern hemisphere here for tropical cyclone energy down here. You're at global and northern hemisphere tropical cyclone at a 30-year low. Global. Okay? All around the world. Hurricanes are not getting worse. They're getting milder. Sure enough, they looked at it over in England and they found the exact same thing. Here's another one. Once again, I'm going to give the interpretation. You correct me if I'm wrong. Goes back to about 1900. We got a current level. Right. Looks like it peaks out a little bit over 6 and drops maybe as low as negative 2. Current level to me looks like it's about 1. So is that a fair statement when I say that that chart is a representation of something being near a 100-year low? It's near the low of the chart, right? That's not an unfair statement, right? I'm not pulling your leg, right? So what did anyone want to take a guess what this chart is? That's your sea level, right? Sea levels are not increasing at any higher rate than they have in the last 100 centuries. In fact, they're near a record low. Okay. Now, more importantly, though, the thing. Supposedly, we have all these glaciers on land that are melting and flooding into the oceans. If that, in fact, was the case, what would you expect to see with the rate of change of sea level? I mean, is it crazy talk for me to say I would expect the rate of change to be going higher, not lower?
Yes.
Right? There you have it. More importantly, take a look at how this is measured. That's millimeters per year. Okay? Let me give you a clue. This is 3 millimeters. You're being told in Hollywood movies or whatever that we're going to flood Manhattan. You want to know how many years of 3 millimeters per year is going to take to flood the Empire State Building? Now, I saw it happen in a movie, but I'm not going to bet my farm on it, right? In fact, if you, once again, if you go over to the UK and read their newspapers, you'll see they point this out. The rise of sea level is the greatest lie ever told. And we heard that lie told at the beginning of this presentation by one of the most powerful men in the world. And once again, they looked at it over in England, and they found the exact same thing. This was the one that really got me scared. You know, I heard, did everyone hear any boaters or anything, or anyone, you hear about how we were going to lose all the polar ice caps, and we were going to have an ice-free North Pole? Remember that last year? We were going to be able to float our boats through the Northern Channel, right? Everyone hear that? We were going to lose all polar bears because they're going to starve, because they're going to be floating around out in the middle of the ocean? I was scared, weren't you? We're going to lose all that ice. I was really scared, so I went and took a look at it. And you know what I found? Sure enough, the polar ice caps are disappearing. This is 1996, 97, in March of 97, and that polar ice cap looked like it's almost gone. Now why don't I care? I couldn't care one iota. Now is it because I'm some mean-spirited conservative that just doesn't like polar bears? Am I the type of guy that goes out and clubs baby seals? Why don't I care that these polar ice caps are disappearing? They're on Mars, right? These polar ice caps are on Mars, okay? Now, last I checked, I don't think there are any Martians driving SUVs, and I'm not sure about it, but I don't think they use coal-burning power plants either, all right? That's a wild guess, though, but I have no evidence of that, all right? So let's take a look here. Here's another chart. Once again, I'm not going to tell you what it is. All I want you to do is you want to tell me, am I misleading you? This looks like it's a chart that goes back to 1979, goes up to 2009, looks like it peaks out around 23, and it looks like it bottoms out around 15. When I look at that, it doesn't look to me like it gets anywhere near zero, ever. Is that a fair statement? When I take a look at this level at 22.5, I'm willing to bet that's near a record high. Am I misleading you in any way whatsoever? No? Well, what is this chart? This is your global sea ice. We haven't lost sea ice. We're near a record high. In fact, if you take a look at it, we finished the same year back as 1979. And why is 79 significant? Wasn't that the year where we had that giant blizzard here and we're hitting record goals? I was reading the newspaper. We had a coming ice age. And we had a 10-year supply of oil. I was scared to death at that time. We're back there. Alright? One thing I find kind of interesting is that they never tell you about the other issue, they always show ice glaciers disappearing and all these catastrophes. Well, if you take a look at Antarctica, Antarctica literally doubles every year and ice. The wintertime it doubles, summertime it shrinks back. Have you ever watched that movie March of the Penguins? That's why they're in such a rush to get to the coast and back, that they miss by a couple of weeks of doubling their trip, and they become extinct. That's what's going on. So ice disappears on a rapid basis every single year. The other thing I find real interesting, I mean, we all know this, that a half-truth is often twice the lie, right? Well, they're always showing you these glaciers down in Antarctica, and they're falling apart. And I remember seeing this one real dramatic thing about it. We lose the Larsen B ice shelf. Watch out. Or this thing the size of Delaware just broke off. Watch out. Well, the problem they don't tell you is Antarctica happened to be a volcanic island. It lies on the Ring of Fire. This is the Larsen B ice shelf right here. Right here is the, this is what's called the Ross ice shelf. It's right on top of Mount Erebus, the dormant volcano. Up here by the Larsen B shelf, you got Penguin Deception, two volcanoes. Don't you think you'd want to know that if you're to form a decision that, by the way, there's a volcano under that melting glacier? I would want to know that, okay? But for some reason, they don't ever seem to want to tell you that. And just the very fact that that kind of information is hidden makes me real skeptical of any conclusion those type of people would ever reach. All right, and take a look. I went digging around at the Bird Polar Research Center. Sure enough, if you dig hard enough, you can find that they're very well aware of it. This is the Ross Ice Shelf. I don't know what the numbers mean, but right here, melt fissure from hot water from a volcano. They are well aware that there's a volcano down there melting glaciers. Did anyone ever know that? No. I'm wondering why you don't know, and that's what bothers me, because remember, we have a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. I don't know why you'd want to hide that kind of stuff from me if you're going to be expecting me to spend my tax dollars to spend it, say something. All right, so I have a real problem with it. All right, now take a look at this chart. Now, everybody in this room has probably seen this chart 1,000 times because you don't know what it is yet. And I'm going to interpret it, and I want you to say, hey, Bob, you're right or wrong. Looks to me like this is something. It looks like a squiggly line. Could be a stop. But we've got a peak here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I have a horizontal line drawn right there at the peak of number 5. And then we have the current level, A, which is below 5 in all other peaks. Is anybody going to disagree with me on that? That's a fair statement, right? So what is that chart? That chart is the chart from Al Gore's own movie. Remember, when he gets on that forklift, he goes, CO2's way up here, run for the hills. That's what he's doing. But he forgets to tell you, and this is what I love about the science, or so-called science, is it's all based on half-truths. He tells you about the CO2, he fails to tell you about the temperature chart. His whole theory is you drive up CO2, you drive up temperature. He's here saying a record high CO2 level, if CO2 drove temperature, if you went to a record high in CO2, what would you expect temperature to do? Cause and effect. You'd expect to see record high temperatures. Al Gore's own chart, if he understood how to read his own chart, totally disproves his own theory. This is what it shows, CO2 going through the roof, temperatures falling to the floor. Going this way, we should be increasing CO2 if we want to cool the globe. His theory is CO2 goes higher, temperature goes higher, but that's not what you observe. You observe the complete opposite. Here's one good quote. What luck for rulers that men don't think, right? Well, we're here to make sure that you can think and you're aware of what's going on, right? The other thing is do a little digging. This is a chart that goes back 600 million years, right? Now, you've been told that CO2 drives temperature, right? But take a look at the charts. This goes back 600 million years. This is temperature, and never, except that little blip right there, never does it get above 22 degrees Celsius. Ever. This is CO2. This is 7,000 parts per million. We're at 380 parts per million right now. That's 20 times as high as the level of CO2 as it's today. 20 times. Atmospheric CO2. Temperature 22. Right here, you have atmospheric CO2 of around 4,500. Over 10 times where we are today, and you fell into an ice age. So we had, at that time, they had over 10 times the level of CO2 in the atmosphere as we do today, and it collapsed into an ice age. You can go throughout this entire chart, and you can go back 600 million years, and never once do you find a really tight correlation between CO2 and temperature. Let me take questions later on. But sure enough, they took a look at it, and that's exactly what they found. In fact, if you really look at it, CO2 follows temperature by about 800 to 1400 years. It's called Henry's Law. It's a fusion of a gas and a liquid. Anyone with a pop bottle knows this. Take a pop bottle, put it on a burner, turn it up, and you'll see CO2 flies out of it. It's written in every single chemistry book in the world. And yet they aren't teaching it in our high schools today. They teach Al Gore's chart back there, which is a great example to show you cause and effect. And yet they don't teach that correctly either. That's the kind of education we're giving our children today. I'm going to flip through these. Okay, just recently, Dr. Costa, had the good fortune of debating someone from the Bird Bowl Research Center. And what it was what I've been doing for the last 4 years is I throw this presentation out and I challenge people to come and prove me wrong, right? Well, someone did that from the Bird Bowl Research Center. They came out and they were going to refute what I said. And what I was surprised to find was that they didn't really refute any of those claims that I've just made. They brought their own evidence, and this is the evidence that was brought. This is called the hockey stick chart, right? I had taken this slide out of my presentation because I thought by now everyone had just realized what a joke it was. I mean, it had been savaged in the scientific community. And I literally had taken it out of the presentation thinking no one would ever bring this thing back up again. Well, it was. Well, this is the hockey stick chart, and this is what is the major component supporting man-made global warming by the IPCC. Everyone know what the IPCC stands for? Intergovernmental. And that's the thing you need to remember. Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. It's a UN organization. Well, here's the chart of what's called the hockey stick chart. This is the chart that they relied on back in 2001 to make the case. Now, once again, you're a forensic scientist. And this may be, I'm going to ask a simple question. You're going to go measure the temperature of something. Your baby has a fever. What do you use to take the temperature? A thermometer. Am I mistaken there? Okay, is there anyone in this room that would not use a thermometer to go measure a temperature of something? Okay, if I ask you to go get a temperature outside, would anybody in here go out and poke a hole in a tree? Or dig up a piece of coral, or go dig up an ice core? No, I don't think so, right? So is it crazy for me to say that if I was going to produce a thermometer or a temperature chart of global temperatures, I would use a thermometer to get those measurements? Is that crazy talk? Right? Well, take a look at the construction of this chart that they're going to use to prove global warming is existing and bill you for it. Okay? Remember, the thermometer was invented in 1593. Right? And there's temperature data going back quite some distance. Matter of fact, here in the U.S., you can go up to Albany, New York and get it back to the early 1700s. The construction uses instrumental data only past 1902. So anything before 1902, there's no thermometer data included. What did they use back here? Ice cores, tree rings, and coral. Now, does anyone see what I would call a tipping point in this chart? Would anyone disagree with me that it looks like it occurs right there at dog leg? That happens to be 1902. So here you have a bunch of proxy data, and then all of a sudden you throw in real data, and it starts shooting through the roof. And then you drop off the proxy data in 1980, and it shoots up even faster. What is that evidence of? That's evidence you have an awful proxy, not that you have global warming, right? What you're doing is you're throwing such bad data in there, it's weighing down the result. When you remove it, it shoots back to normal. However, you got to ask yourself, why, if you had thermometer data, don't you use it for global temperatures? It makes no sense to me, right? It may make sense to the IPCC and Al Gore, but it makes no sense to me. Here's the other thing. This is a chart you're going to see a lot of, okay? And this is another chart that they use. Okay? The key here is the way that they get this data is through ground measurements, right? They go around, they have all these little infinite variability of these little ground measurements, little stations all over the place, and they put them all together and they compile a result. And this is the temperature chart they show, right? And it looks to me pretty ominous. This looks to me like temperatures shooting through the roof. Okay, first of all, half of the warming of the last century occurred in the first half of the century, way before CO2 was increased. The warming of this part increased at about the same rate, right? Then you would expect if CO2 was driving it, the rate of increase would be faster. So So right off the bat, I think you've got a problem just using their own data. But let's take a look at how they construct this data. Okay? This is a weather station that is properly run. Right? There's no shadows on it. There's no blacktop around it. There's no burning grill next to it. It's out in the middle of nowhere. Nothing to absorb heat. And it measures the temperature. This is out in California. Right? This is the temperature over the last 100 years of a properly run thermometer or weather station. Temperatures are falling through the floor over the last 100 years according to good measurements. Right? Now you go two blocks away and you see this. This is the temperature chart going back 100 years to this weather station. And you can get this data off surfacestation.org. It's shooting through the roof. First of all, that's not evidence of global warming. That's global warming, because if it's global warming, both these stations would be going higher. The key is, the well-run one shows no warming. This one shows good warming. The problem is they throw those two together, and what do you think your weather, your temperature chart's going to show? Temperature's rising. It's not rising because of CO2. It's because this yahoo put it on top of asphalt, and they can't figure out how the driveway's getting hot when the sun comes out. That's what happens. All right? Now, that data is compiled by NASA. Right? What's NASA known for? Satellites. Doesn't NASA have satellites to measure temperature? You betcha they do. And you don't want to know what they say about their temperature measurements? This is from the NASA Marshall Space Center. Recently, much scientific debate has focused on the global temperature of the Earth's lower atmosphere as measured by orbiting satellites. And while these data are exceedingly precise, unlike those previous ground measurements, verified by multiple satellite observations, which is good science, you test it and test it and test it again, get a real robust data set, and balloon measurements taken in situ, meaning that they get one measurement and they say, okay, let's go test it a different way just to confirm that we're doing it right. So these guys at NASA really have it down. They know how to run a real good scientific experiment. And with their satellites, they do a great job. And what did they find with the satellite data? There's no discernible warming trend in the Earth's lower atmosphere in the last 18 plus years. And that was 1997. 10 years since then, it's cooler. So you haven't had warming, according to the most accurate measurement temperature out there, for the last 30 years. And yet you're being told you're going through a catastrophic warming period. The satellites don't tell that. So what I did, and this is basically a satellite measurement, and as you can see, you're back where you were in 1980. You had a little blip here, but that was due to El Nino. And that's a sharply decreasing trend over the last decade, while all this hype was being hyped up. Right? So what I did was I said, okay, let's use the most accurate data and create a temperature chart. So I deleted past 1980 or 79, and I tacked on the satellite data. Now, does this look as ominous? No, that's not scary at all. That's a flat temperature. This is 1934, I believe. So we're below where we, way below where we were in 1934. And yet you're being told that we're going through some catastrophic warming period. When you overlap the two, you can see this increases quite a bit. Satellites stay the same. If you talk to Dr. Pachuri with the IPCC, what does he tell you? It's been sure, we're at a stage where warming is taking place at a much faster rate. How does he get that data? I have no idea, but that's what you're being told by the IPCC. Over here, global warming seems worse than predicted. Who's doing the prediction? And who's reading the conclusion? Right? I don't know how they reach those conclusions, but when you look at the data, I don't see it. Now this is a, this gets up a pretty much the crux of the science. These are all the greenhouse gases, and I've removed what they are. And the way you read this chart is you have greenhouse gas 1 through 5, and right here is when you sum all of them together, you get total atmosphere absorption. Right? And so when you look up here, you can see one of these greenhouse gases looks like it absorbs a whole heck of a lot that's very similar to this atmosphere. Anyone want to take a guess at which one looks like it mirrors this total atmosphere? Anyone want to tell me which one is number 1 through 5? What I find funny is by the time I get this far in the presentation, no one will even guess that. Okay. But when I look at this, I would say 5. Okay? Okay, number 5 looks like it almost overlaps the total atmosphere absorption almost perfectly, right? Certainly not number 1. You got these two little spikes. Yeah, that's nothing. Okay, so if number 5 is the most significant greenhouse gas, what is it?
CO2.
Who said CO2? Raise your hand. CO2, is anyone going to disagree with this man that CO2 You're going to disagree with me?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, but most people would agree, right? Al Gore told me it was most of them, Dr. Krause, you got to stay out of this. Until a little later. All right? All right? You'll have your chance. but yeah, it's CO2. Al Gore's been telling me that. They tell my kids that in their public schools, right? They make them watch the movie, right? So it's got to be CO2, right? Am I wrong there? Should that not be CO2?
Methane.
No. Close. It's water vapor. Who knew it was water vapor? Okay, now let me give you a little clue. Water vapor swings from 0 to 4%. That's 4 parts per 100. Right? Right now, you've got extreme water vapor in the air out there. Are you going through catastrophic warming right now? I mean, that's a huge swing, 0 to 4%. You want to know what atmospheric CO2 is? 380 parts per million. Get out your calculator. Some of the digits won't even go back that far. 0.038%. And man only produces 5% of that. All right? So when you take a look at it, the only, this is CO2 right here. It overlaps water vapor. So with or without CO2, it'd be absorbing the same thing. Here is the only part that doesn't overlap with water vapor. So when you take a close look at it, man only produces 5% of atmospheric CO2. So it's 5% of that little buildup is what's causing all this catastrophic warming. Anyone believe that? I don't buy it at all. Right? And when you take a look at a thermogram, this is basically atmospheric water vapor, atmospheric temperature. They fit like a glove. Right? But I'm willing to bet most of you never knew water vapor is by far the most significant greenhouse gas. And why aren't we out there trying to stop the water polluters? You know, why aren't we going to go try to stop Mother Nature from allowing her ponds to evaporate? You know, or the trees producing all their water vapor? You know? But we're not doing it. We're going after CO2. The other thing is you were told in that video of the famine and the drought. So if you have famine and drought, what do you need? If you have famine, you have to have a decrease in food production, right? I imagine many of you work in the agricultural field. Right? What is this? Anyone want to tell me what this is? Well, it's a greenhouse. That's a CO2 generator. Why do they have CO2 generators in greenhouses? Because as you increase the level of CO2 in the atmosphere, the crop yield increases as well. CO2 is plant food. We die without atmospheric CO2. Alright? In fact, we had a record harvest last year and this year. So how can you have famine if we're producing more food now than ever before in history, if it's due to global warming? If anything, global warming is creating more food, which to me, I would think, is a good thing. Things grow as it warms up. Things don't grow during ice ages. Go find a farm up in the Antarctica. You're not going to find one, all right? All right? This goes to the IPCC, right? So also, you heard about record drought. Well, I went to the IPCC and got their report. What do they tell you? You don't have record drought in the northern hemisphere. In fact, across the board, you have nothing but increasing precipitation in almost every area. So how are you having record drought if you have record precipitation? The numbers don't add up. And sure enough, when they took a look at it over in England, they found the exact same thing. Last thing, I'm just going to flip through these now, because I think you've got my point. I can keep beating this dead horse. This actually could be a three-hour lecture. And by the time people are getting ready to, you know, just fall over and say, okay, you beat the horse, you know, it's dead. Right? But I think we all get the clue that there's a lot of problems with the science. All right, this is basically just a chart that shows solar radiation, temperature, and CO2. Anyone want to take a guess which? As you can see, solar radiation and temperature overlap almost perfectly. Now, who would have thunk that? The sun drives global warming? That's crazy talk, right? CO2 doesn't play at all. Right? In fact, they know. When they took a look at it, scientists, sun's to blame for global warming. Okay? Our very own army is out there saying, hold on, guys. Can you take a look at this data? This is the sun causing it. What's nice about this, and I'm saying this as a conservative, is that, like I said, I build financial models. And I know one thing. I can build the best model in the world. The S&P 500 or Dow Jones Industrial is going to do what it wants to do, right? And if I bet the farm in it, and I'm ever so confident that it's going one way, it turns around on me. What's nice about this is everybody has bet the farm on this one. They've told the UN's told you this, the media's told you this, the academic community's told you this, right? Well, the
problem is, Mother Nature doesn't necessarily agree with him. And she started to turn on him. Now, like I said, back when I was a kid, there was coming ice age. Well, the sun's getting cool again. And so probably what I'm going to speculate is that you're going to see over the next 5-6 years, temperatures getting much cooler. And I'm kind of eager to find and see these people defend themselves when we start having record low temperatures popping up instead of record high. So as a conservative, I'm kind of eager to see this. The other thing is, this is the last set I'll cover, right? The other thing is, if you have a good model, you have to have consistent data, right? If I'm going to model the S&P 500, I have to have good, consistent data for the S&P 500. Well, this is the IPCC report, figure 7C, back in 1990. And as you can see, it has the medieval warming period, the little ice age, and then this is the current level. The current level is way below where you were in the middle of the medieval warming period. Right? This is when the Vikings inhabited Greenland. And you had wineries in northern England. Anyone see a problem with this chart? You're the IPCC, and you're trying to make the case that CO2 is leading to catastrophic global warming. See a problem with this chart?
There wasn't
dogs on wheels in 1,000 I may be going out on a limb with this one, but I don't think the Vikings drove SUVs and they didn't have coal-burning power plants. I made a mistake there, alright? Correct me if I'm wrong. But you see a problem with that? You're the IPCC, you're Al Gore trying to make the case of catastrophic warming. What's your chart telling you? There's no catastrophic warming. So what do you do in that case? Do you come out and say, oh, by the way, I was wrong, forgive me, you don't want to go waste all that money? What do? You get rid of that chart. Right. You get rid of that chart in a big way. Here's the chart of the charts here. It goes, get this one, this is the hockey stick chart. All right, well, people got in such an uproar about this one, they replaced it with this one. So what the important point here is, back in 1990, they had a consensus. 91, they totally had a new chart, but they still had the consensus, and now they have another chart, and they still have a consensus. How can you have a consistent consensus when you're consistently changing the most important variable of your model, the dependent variable? That just shows you can give them any data set they want, and they're going to have the same conclusion. I could give them the Dow Jones Industrial and say, yeah, it's global warming. All right? This is one of the things I just find kind of interesting as far as society goes. This is a Gallup poll. It goes back to 1998. And as you can see, you have three groups of people in America. You have two-thirds of them start out about 35, 34, and one group starts out at 23. And over time, new data comes to light. And over time, two-thirds of America, their opinions change. One-third of America starts at 23 and goes to 22. They actually become more convinced. So you have two-thirds of the population becoming, their attitudes are changing, one set becomes more convinced. It's kind of like men are from Mars, women from Venus, right? Sets of people just view things totally different, right? And this, and they mapped it out. Well, what is this chart? This chart is skepticism on global, mainly global warming. The independents and the conservatives, they've become much more skeptical. The Democrats have actually become more convinced. Now, I don't know how you become more convinced looking at that science, but it's true. And I think this is one of the biggest challenges we have in society. And that's why I'm out here right now trying to force the conversation on this so that we all start understanding what we're talking about. Right? There's also the thing you'll hear about a consensus. There's no consensus. Right? The U.S. Senate Minority Report actually mocks it. They keep 650 international scientists dissent. The petition project, 31,000 scientists. After offering to pay Al Gore $100,000 to debate this issue in public, like what I've been doing, and what I always do, come on, prove it in public. You know, let me show you the charts and we'll debate it. Right? They keep logging it. They keep jacking it up every so much. It's like they're literally trying to mock it, saying, "You guys, this is nothing here." China or Japan? Japan's Society of Energy and Resources. Mainly global warming theories like ancient astrology. They're mocking it, right? I'm going to just flip through these. This is why this is Henry's Law. Take a look at your chemistry book. It explains CO2 and water. And water. The oceans are like the hemoglobin of the earth. You warm it and throw CO2 out. It's not doing man. Now, you're going to ask, why would they do this? And so I just put a couple clips here. And then we're going to just have a real quick couple comments on the economics and we'll go from there.
But carbon dioxide clearly is an industrial gas. And so tying in with
to growth, and to development, and above all, and it is our great state in the U.S. Patrick Moore is considered one of the foremost environmentalists of his generation. He is co-founder of Greenpeace.
The shift to climate being a major focal point came about for two very distinct reasons. The first reason was because by the mid-80s, the majority of people now agreed with all the reasonable things we in the environmental movement were saying they should do. Now, when a majority of people agree with you, it's pretty hard to remain confrontational with them. And so the only way to remain anti-establishment was to adopt ever more extreme positions. When I left Greenpeace, it was in the midst of them adopting a campaign to ban chlorine worldwide. Like I said, you guys, this is one of the elements in the periodic table, you know. I mean, I'm not sure if that's in our jurisdiction to be banning a whole element. The other reason that environmental extremism emerged was because world communism failed, the wall came down, and a lot of peaceniks and political activists moved into the environmental movement, bringing their neo-Marxism with them, and learned to use green language in a very clever way to cloak agendas that actually have more to do with anti-capitalism and anti-globalization than they do anything with ecology or science.
The left have been slightly disoriented by the manifest failure of socialism and indeed also communism as it was tried out. And therefore, they're still labeled as anti-capitalists as they were, but they had to find a new guise for their anti-capitalism. And it was a kind of amazing alliance from Margaret Thatcher on the right through to very left-wing anti-capitalist environmentalists that created this kind of momentum behind the loony idea.
I love that loony idea. And when you take a look at what they're proposing now, and you just saw the science behind it, right? If you take a look at what they're proposing, they are proposing what I would call economic suicide. When you take a look, even the EPA points out, okay, that serious economic impacts would be injected upon society if they go through what they're talking about. This was sent to me by Sid, and it is a very well done piece by the Heritage Foundation, and it shows you who's going to get hit, because they're going to go after the coal burning power plants. You can see Ohio's red over here. This is Wagner. He's saying it's going to cost the family $3,100 a year. I don't want to spend $3,100 a year so I can go kill jobs and kill our economy. Right? That's what they're talking about. In this Heritage Foundation, they have a chart that shows you, you know, who's at risk. Here's Binder, Jerry. This is what's called the Manufacturing Vulnerability Index. You can see Ohio is very high on that because we get a large amount of our electricity through coal-burning power plants. Your area here with James Jordan, you rate 99.3. Okay? Your area is at high risk for losing jobs with any kind of EPA legislation or climate change legislation. And I think this message gets to drive some of the message to a T. I'm not sure what we should call this climate bill. We need a catchy phrase to hide the hidden costs. Okay? Why don't we just call it the Asian Full Employment Act? And that's exactly what would happen. Alright? If you're a manufacturer, if you're whatever you can, if you can pick up your factory and you can get it out of the US to avoid all these regulations, you're going to do it. And what breaks my heart is this was right when we were starting to get the manufacturing base back. And now we're going to slap all these regulations and taxes on them and we're going to chase them from our shores again. Right? We need those jobs here. Right? Remember, we've already been through this. Remember how they're telling us we have to invest in all this ethanol and biofuels and everything like that? Well, now the UN's saying, wait a minute, we were wrong, stop it. We don't want to burn food while people are starving. Right? Now they're backtracking. Ethanol plants are now going bankrupt. And it kills our cars. One of those are fighting, it destroys our engines. Right? This is another thing, right? The benefits that they're talking about are 100% pure speculation. Okay, Japan and Germany have some of the best engineers in the world. They've paid higher prices for decades, and they aren't even close to an alternative energy source. And yet you're being told that we're gonna put these people out of work and put them to work, what? Watching a windmill generate electricity, right? I mean, where are these jobs? They don't exist yet, and we're gonna for certain put them out of work and hope to God we can
find a new place to put in the work. Okay? I wouldn't buy it. I'd say you invent the alternative energy source first and then put me out of work. Don't put me out of work and just so that's like back in Henry Ford's day. We decided to let loose all the horses before we invent the car and just hope that somehow we invent the automobile in the next couple of years. And here's what they're doing. This is what it really is. To me, this is what this is all about. This is from our taxpayer-funded PBS.
In December.
This is Dr. Venturi from the IPCC, and he tells you what this is all about.
7 countries arrived in Bali, Indonesia, for the United Nations Climate Change Conference. Diplomats and scientists were convened to try to strike a new global climate treaty. As Dr. Rajendra Pachauri arrived, the IPCC had just issued a string of ever more urgent reports. He was hoping that governments, especially the U.S., were finally listening. Ironically, the Bush administration had welcomed Pachauri to the IPCC, expecting that this engineer, an economist, on the board of several large Indian energy companies, would be cautious and sympathetic to the U.S. position on climate change.
If we lose momentum over here, then we have a very short period of time.
Instead, Pachauri has repeatedly sounded the alarm and put responsibility squarely on businesses and governments in the industrialized West.
It seems to be the most critical issue.
People said they started to responsibility for the problem, the fact that the concentration of greenhouse gases is essentially the result of emissions that have taken place for 150 plus years, largely in the developed countries. That's one reason. And the second reason is that in terms of economic and technological capacity, the developed countries are certainly better equipped to do something about this than the developing world.
U.S. negotiators in Bali didn't see it that way.
Next is the United States.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Unfortunately, there have been many strong statements.
They maintained that America would make no cuts unless developing nations also agreed. And they didn't expect what happened next.
So I just want to state these preferences of the developing countries.
For the first time, developing countries stepped forward and said, we will negotiate verifiable, measurable, and reportable emissions reduction measures to be incorporated in the treaty.
Okay, get that message? The message was, America did this, they've got to fix it. We're responsible for all the atmospheric CO2 that's causing all this harm. And the other solution was, from each according to their ability, to each according to their need. Because we are wealthy, we get to foot the bill. We cause it, we get to clean up the mess. And that's the UN telling you that. All right? Now,
changing our world.
Okay, now what do you hear there? You hear that we are going to, our federal government the government of the people, by the people, for the people, the government that is supposed to promote the general welfare is going to bankrupt our power plant. While, in the same sentence, he says that China's building those things that we're about to bankrupt on a weekly basis. And then we are told that petroleum and fossil fuels make us sick. The petroleum fossil fuels fuel our tractors that provide us the best standard of living in the world. They provide all the electricity that keeps our hospitals alive. There's not a single person in the world that doesn't benefit greatly from fossil fuels being burned and providing us the highest standard of living in the world. And yet you're being told driving your car is making you sick. It allows me to get to work, pay for the roof above my head, and put food on my table. And yet you're being told this is the evil one. All right. And lastly, alright, this is what it all comes down to. China, this to me is like America falling on its economic sword. China is no fool. They understand that the way to catch America and to plant us as the number one power is you get us to destroy ourselves. And that's what this carbon legislation would do. China is now lecturing us. China, the nation of the one-child policy, the enforced infanticide, is now lecturing us that we must cut our emissions because we're polluters. Who said we must ditch our unsustainable lifestyle. If I was China, I'd be begging for America to do what we're about to do because it would make it very easy for me to catch it. In fact, go to the UN's website, and this is what it's all about. Just simply follow the money. It's something called the Clean Development Mechanism. All right? Go to the UN website, and what it does is you sign on to Kyoto, you pay the UN. You know they used to have the Food for Oil program? They now have the Food for Carbon program. Right? One scam fell apart, so they came up with another one. You give the money to the UN, and they channel the money to the developed world. It's from each according to their ability, to each according to their need. And take a look at who gets the majority of that money. China. If we sign on to Kyoto or any of these things that have to do with the Clean Development Mechanism, we will be taking money from our children and giving it to rebuild China. Now, we did that after World War II. We rebuilt Japan. They came back and thanked us in the auto industry in the 70s, right? Well, I don't want to face a fiercely competitive China built at my expense or my children's expense, and that's what we're doing. That's what they're talking about. No wonder the third world jumped on to, oh yeah, we signed up for this carbon credit stuff because you're the one that gets it. We're the ones that pay for it. All right? It's going to cost $750 billion. That's if we haven't run up the debt enough. Right? The other thing is, here's a comparative of the alternative energy sources. They're not even close. You're talking $23 versus 25 cents compared to gas. We're not even close. Right? The other last thing I want to cover is what it's going to do to the farmer. If I was a family farmer, I would pay real tight attention to this. The EPA admits themselves that the legislation they're talking about will bankrupt the family farm. And it's written in their own report. Okay? These operations, they're talking about the small family farm, these operations simply could not bear the regulatory compliance costs that would be involved. The federal government, the government of the people, by the people, for the people, who's supposed to promote the general welfare, they are saying if we do this, we are going to hurt, destroy, bankrupt the backbone of America. And that's what I think is the most important thing. This legislation is economic suicide. And if we allow that, allow them to get away with it, we're going to pay a serious price, and most of all, our children, because these are serious financial crises right now. We've got real problems. We have a $90 trillion unfunded liability of Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. We've got to provide health care and pension plans for our elderly. And now we're going to start pouring money to pull CO2 out of the atmosphere, and nobody can tell me the benefits that you're going to get from pulling CO2 out of the atmosphere. There's no sample for you to measure what the difference would have been. But I can tell you one thing. The costs are significant and real. The benefits are highly speculative, if existent at all. And that's the take-home message. Right? There is certain harm to be done, and I can't see any benefits. And that's all the presentation I have. Now we're just going to open up to question and answer.
Unemployment for anybody that has lost their job because of a green job. That's written in the cap and trade.
Yeah, but to me, why would we want to be paying farmers not to produce food?
Right.
I mean, if you produce food, you drive the price of food down. If we go out and we start paying our farmers not to produce, the price of food goes higher. To me, that's not a solution, and I wouldn't want the federal government tampering in the food industry. The other thing is, who do you think is going to pay for this 150 months of or weeks of unemployment? Our children, we do. Why would I want to put people out of work for 150 weeks hoping that we come up with an alternative energy source? I mean, I teach economics. This is, to me, it's the most bizarre economics I've ever heard said.